Second agenda item is the acceptance of the agenda, and I take a motion.
Move to accept.
Motion by Mr. Norton. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. All in favor? Aye.
Welcome back.
Thank you, Tony.
To welcome Mr. Murray back to
Thank
the board.
Thank you very much.
On that same second agenda item is the walk-in period. Are there any walk-ins? Seeing none, I'd like to now move on to the third agenda item, which is a discussion vote one-day wine and malt beverage license to St. Mary's.
We have to pay some for some services when we do that. These are on authorizations already voted at town meeting and approved for us to go forward, whether it's to purchase equipment, do work in the town, studies, etc. This is another option to those formal types of borrowing where the town is allowed by the Department of Revenue to borrow against itself. I have to do a form, which all of you received in your package. I have the originals there to be signed. And we borrow against, on paper, the stabilization fund that the town has, which we have $2.2 million in it. So it just saves us some money in the issuance costs of some of the more traditional short-term borrowings. So, and the Department of Revenue requires that they're all resolved with another type of borrowing, a bond or a ban, by June 30th of every year. So the document that all of you sign and I sign, when it's taken care of, then the town accountant signs off and I send that to the DOR that it's been resolved. So.
And this evening you're looking to do, it looks like, five different borrowings for five different projects or items.
Correct. And I didn't, there are restrictions on how quickly you're supposed to spend funds once you borrow. You can't borrow money and have it sitting in a bank account collecting interest. So I didn't, as you know, I did a traditional short-term borrowing about a month and a half ago. Because the weather was mild enough, Kevin Cafferty of the DPW was able to continue on some of the projects, the water main work that he was doing. But at the time I was preparing for the other borrowing, I didn't know that that would be the case. So I have the Stockbridge Road project and the just a general water main article from the Springs annual town meeting that I want to borrow against. And also there was some fire hydrants that have to be purchased. So that's an item of $25,000. And then the dump truck in the body sander body plow package, that's for some equipment. And that was ordered a few months ago, so I didn't want to borrow until it was in. So it's in and ready for pickup, I believe. So we want to pay that and get it for the snow.
And the total amount that you're looking for this interfund advance borrowings for $660,000?
Correct. And I will take care of those in March with a bond anticipation note that I'll be doing for the town at that time.
And it looks as though, at least from the progress I saw today, it looks like the Stockbridge water main has been completed, or it will be completed if it wasn't today, by tomorrow. So
you can ask Kevin, he's up
it's
next.
Pretty quick.
They still have to go back in and do all the services. It's just the main line.
Questions from the board?
Just
Senator
one,
Murray.
One quick thing. So these have all been approved by town meeting and so on and so forth.
That's correct.
Just to make clear to people watching here that this is nothing new. This is just to fund things that the town's people have all approved.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mr. Mignotti.
Jane, we've done quite a few of these. Have all the ones up to this been banned already?
Most of them were. I intentionally did not include the two Roses Lanes that you approved previously. Or the Wampatuck School, because the borrowing from them is going to be a little bit different. The Roses Lane, it's been an ongoing issue trying to resolve that with the Water Pollution Abatement Trust and some ARRA funds that the town had been pursuing. So our bond council attorneys had been working on that with the executive director of the trust.
My question is more, this is $660,000.
Correct.
We're borrowing on the $2 million stabilization fund. How much leverage do we have here? What's the total
We can
amount?
Borrow right up to the $2.2 million against it. Uh-huh. This is all going to be resolved in March. There's $247,000 outstanding. It's the Two Roses Lane in the Wampatuck School.
So the $247,000, so total, there's about $900,000.
More efficient
and it saves money in the long run because we spend less money cleaning up all the sand with the sweep running. So a lot of what we were putting out in the roads today, you can correct me, Mike, is our old salt and sand mix that we had from last year, just to get rid of it and use it all up so that we can switch over to the 100% salt. It was already pre-mixed. But other than that, it should work out pretty well.
Questions at all from the board?
Two quick questions. Does salt disintegrate as where sand doesn't, so you don't have to clean up the salt?
Correct.
Okay. Correct. And when do you typically start plowing? Like last, we had a storm yesterday. I don't know when it started snowing here, but you know, the roads were pretty messy between 4 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
Do you really wait for it to cut, just so people know, do you wait for a couple inches before you send the trucks out there to start plowing, or what is the, when should people expect to see plows going down the street?
Ideally, what we're going to be doing is, and speak up, don't, you know, don't let me say everything. We'll put the anti-icing agent on the road and let that sit in, and as the car's working in, that will melt. If we put the blades out right away, we'll be scraping up the anti-icing agent, and we'll just be doing damage to the blades. So there will have to be a little snow buildup before we can put all the plows out there.
So plows won't go out until the storm has progressed a little bit, but know that there's some sort of
we have to watch it, though. Mike's going to keep an eye on that. And we have temperature gauges so we can judge the temperature of the road. If the roadway temperature is up above 32 freezing, that snow's melting. So by bringing the plows out or even applying the anti-icing agent, we're not gaining anything because it's going to melt anyway. So it's a call that Mike or the foreman will make at that time as they measure the road temperature and see what it looks like.
Okay.
So every storm's different, I think, too. Like yesterday, it was supposed to be 1 inch to 2 inches, which we were fighting it with just the town workers without calling the contractors in for a long time, salting the mains, and it was keeping up, and the roads were staying black. And then the storm just progressed to something that we didn't expect. And as soon as it started, we started to lose control of the roads. We stopped putting the material down because we were just wasting money. And that's when we called out the contractors and started to get the roads cleared. And as soon as the roads were cleared, again, the forecast was wrong, saying it was going to be 18 degrees this morning. So I made sure we had all the roads sanded, and the temperature was 30 coming in this morning. So it's, every storm is different, and you make a call, and it could be right or wrong or bad, but you just play it by ear, but how it goes.
Mr. Murray.
Yeah, what's the salt brine made out of? What's the composition of it?
Water and 23% salt.
Which
regular
salt?
Rock salt.
Rock.
We
magnesium
place it
or
in
sodium?
With loader. No, just regular rock salt that
sodium
we normally
form.
Buy
okay.
Anyways.
Yeah, okay.
It mixes in. We have a mixing system,
yeah. And
it's set up accordingly.
Okay. Regarding the weather service, I'd just be very careful about spending money, too much money on that. I think it's always good to get another opinion. And I was very pleased to hear you're talking to Mr. Kelly about that, because he knows about that obviously far more than I. But just in general, they're all getting a lot of their input from the same national and local weather forecasts. In fact, in hurricane season, when you can watch the TV, channels 4, 5, and 7, and then you get on the NOAA website, and you can just see they're reading the same stuff you're reading.
Mm-hmm.
And they also are just weather forecasters. Some of them are as good, some of them are not as good as the people on the TV. And so it sounds like it's a nice idea, and it is, I support getting as much information as possible to make as informed decision as possible.
Mm-hmm.
But just because they're a private company or something separate from the television, they're not necessarily better. So I think it's a good idea to get more information, but just be careful of the finances involved.
It's something to look at. And how many pieces do you have regularly on in a storm?
Talking plows or sanding?
Everything, plows, sanders, the whole works.
50?
Yeah, for sure. You got a lot of equipment out there.
With the contractors, everybody?
Yeah, probably 40 to...
So any savings you can have are absolutely going to be great.
Our thought is if we brought them in 2 hours early by going by channel 4 and we have 40 pieces of equipment that we're paying minimum $60,
yep. You
know, we're just trying to, we're thinking of ways to save. I mean, it might work, it might not.
I completely agree.
Kevin, if I could just, Mr. Harris had a question to Mr. Norton.
Oh, go first, Joe. Mike, when the private plowers go out, do they get a minimum? Is there a minimum number of hours they're out for? So if they're out for 2 hours, they're out for 2 hours. Okay. And the other thing, as far as the weather service. Years ago, we had a weather service, you know, mm-hmm. 20 years ago, I guess, probably. And they did away with it because I think the feeling was Channel 4 was just as up to date as the national weather thing that we get faxed into us. So just in a point. If it's, if it's very expensive, I'd give it a good.
If it's outrageous money, I'm sure Trisha won't let us do it. No, I'm kidding.
Sure she won't.
But no,
Al won't let you do it. That's
yeah, okay. And Tim Kelly was. We were talking to Tim Kelly, and he is supposed to meet with us next week, and maybe he can help us out with
that's
that.
That's great.
So that would be what I'd like to say.
Absolutely.
Just a comment. What's happened in the past, Mike will attest to it. When you spread the sand down, which it, and then the cars are driving over it, it gets packed down, and then it's a waste of time plowing. That just doesn't amount to anything. But hopefully, with the salt, like the state does, they put the salt and the liquid chemicals down. It'll make it slushy. So when you do scrape it, it'll make a big difference. So I look forward to seeing that difference. That's all.
Other questions?
Well, one of the other things we were going to offer is. Next Thursday, December 30th, from like 9 to 11, over by the transfer station is where we have the salt brine system set up. And if anybody wants to come over and see it, have a little tour or see what we're doing and how we're using it with the trucks, Mike and I will be there and we can explain it to everybody and just let them see what we're doing. Firing a snowstorm. It's always up for cancellation, but it's an option if anybody's interested in seeing it.
December 30th from 9 to 11.
9 to 11. Right adjacent to the transfer station where the flare is.
Yep.
Off to the right-hand side there. We've got our building set up and everything will be up and running.
Questions from the audience?
Good. Thank you very much.
Gentlemen, thank you. Thanks, guys. Very much. Happy holidays. Thank you.
You too.
Okay, moving on to agenda item number 7. It's a discussion. I'm sorry, number 6. It's the fiscal year 2012 capital and operating budget overview with the town administrator. And just so those people who are watching, we ended up starting our meeting at 7:07, and TV came on at like 7:10. So just there's a little delay for you folks. So, thanks. Tricia, how would you like to proceed?
I guess with your permission, I'd like to sort of give an overview of the budget process and some of the documents of your budget and to take a little time to do it. Since most of the budgets you're seeing are rather straightforward tonight and in some cases lower than they were in FY 11. So, and one of the reasons is, you know, I think we as a community can be really proud of the budget document and the time that the department heads now put into crafting their budget requests, which really aren't just about dollars and more money or less money, but really about how those departments are managed and what they hope to achieve. So the first thing I want to talk about is the capital plan, briefly, which you have as part of your budget book. I don't want to talk too much about it because you're scheduled to do it later in your budget calendar. However, as you know, the entire process was revamped this year and a new process implemented whereby I actually do a recommended capital budget just like I do a recommended operating budget. It's provided for in the charter. It doesn't usurp the work of the Capital Planning Committee. They can, as the advisory and the board does, look at the recommendations I made and change them, amend them, or revise them, or whatever. But there is a capital plan. The projects have all been rated on a objective, quantitative rating system that's in wide use throughout the country, and a recommended funding mechanism for those capital items I have recommended as well. Capital planning has all that. They will be meeting over the next several months with all the various people who put requests in, and then we'll have some recommendations hopefully for town meeting. One of the things that it's important to note is part of the way that this capital plan will be successful is if we have to cull out some operating revenue in the future to start to fund this. Generally, I'm recommending 2-3%. That's not happening in FY12. There's no impact to the operating revenue since we've already forecasted that revenue for budgets for FY12. However, the future budgets that you see from me in FY13 are going to pull 3% or somewhere between 2-3%, probably around 2.3, 2.5 of our revenue that typically has gone to operating and is going to allocate it to capital. The town has treated the capital planning process is an after the fact, and it has to be treated concurrently with the operating budget. It's not an either or, it's an and that's a significant change. But we have, as you'll see, over $13 million of requests in FY12 alone for capital. And the recommendations I have made are slightly over $3 million with a combination of pay-as-you-go as well as bonding. So you have those. Tony, I have a revised thing for you to slip into your thing that I think the board got. I really don't want to say too much more than that, except that I'm glad it's done. Because it was, you know, we changed the operating budget last year, and now this year we did capital, so next year should be easier. The next thing I want to talk about is to segue.
Can I ask a quick question on that before we go off? When you say an addition, currently we spend about 2.1% of our budget on debt and interest. When you say, do you mean an additional 2.5% to that, or maintain it at that 2.1%?
It maintain it at that 2.1. The difference is if we do 2.1 or move more to 2.9 or 3.
Right.
Most communities are at 4 or 5%. So, you know, when we look at this as a challenge to call out the 2 to 3%, most communities are at 5%. And they have that regular rolling capital. So.
Right. And the only problem, but the only dilemma, first of all, this is a great document. This is, you know, a ton of work has been put into this. It's wonderful. The problem with it is when you take the money to put it towards the capital, which is obviously the infrastructure of the town that we need to keep building on, that's been, you know, kind of put in the back seat for many, many years, it comes out of the operating budget. So we already have departments that don't have enough money to operate on the current split of revenue, so this will reduce that more. So it's really a hard, there's no easy solution. You know, if you're going to take more for this, I mean, every year the board's had that dilemma. You know, can we afford that new fire truck, because it's got to come from somewhere, and it's going to cost a teacher and a policeman or whatever, you know, whatever it happens to be. So it's going to be a challenging time.
Right, and the problem is we can't ignore the capital anymore. And if I have to recommend a budget to you next year that's funding needed capital because the ladder truck is not going to pass inspection after 25 years,
right,
then, and a layoff results in that, then I might have to make that decision unless we, you know, find other ways to have revenue. And those are the tough choices we have to make.
Exactly.
Sean, I just think it's important, Tricia, you mentioned it. Other neighboring towns spend about 5% on their capital budget. And we're around two. I think that's
a
important.
Successful capital plan that has a rolling five-year capital is regularly funding and bonding and taking about 5% of net revenue.
And is that a difference between enterprise funds or pay-as-you-go or bonding it separately? Or how does that, just a general for the other towns if they're doing it 4 to 5%?
It's all in, but that 2 to 3% is for general fund. That's been where we always fall down, is we're able to do some enterprise, use some free cash, maybe do some that. It's, you know, general fund supported capital that we've had a challenge with, because
just for
we need those as operating revenues.
Purpose of people who are watching and people here, when you say pay as you go, what do you mean by that?
Pay as you go is funds that we have available now, like free cash, like retired debt service. So let's say our debt service is $1 million in FY11 and we retire some debt in FY12, so it's only $900,000. We will never release that debt surplus back into the general fund. We will keep that as $100,000 to be plowed back into additional capital. Interest from stabilization is another way to do it. So that's traditional pay-as-you-go. So then now moving on to the operating budget, the first section of the budget you have is my budget message, which I'll go through. The latter part of that contains the revenue and expense assumptions that we did last year that are now showing a five-year historical history of expenditures and revenue forecasting up against actuals for all the main expense and revenue line items for the town, like the property tax levy, unemployment, local aid, abatements and exemptions, Medicare reimbursements, FICA costs, health insurance, pension. And Jane and Steve and Mary and I sit together about three times a year and look at this and then update it before we start the budget process. This is separate from the Financial Forecasting Committee. We just met today at 6 to tie all of that together, but really what we're doing is building a historical database to see, well, if it's been like this for the last 5 years, we have a reasonable expectation maybe that it might look like this. So there's lots of charts and graphs there, so I hope you take some time to look at it. It will be posted on the website under the Town Administrator section probably next week. So now let me talk a little bit about the FY12 budget. The budget is balanced. It doesn't use any free cash to balance the budget again. Overall, I had departmental requested increases over FY11 of about $600,000. I cut over $300,000 from that budget. This is a budget that I say...
Tricia?
Yes.
You just went through that pretty fast.
Okay.
So the department's requests were a $600,000 increase. You did not approve approximately half of those.
Right, but let me explain that number. First, some of those are driven by increases in fixed costs.
Understood.
So the FY11 budget to the FY12 budget on the town side was up.
By 600.
Right. Some of that is step increases. Some of those are increases.
Which are all fixed costs. Right. We have no control over anyways. Absolutely. Right. Okay.
Sorry, I'm just...
But nonetheless, you were able to discuss those submitted budgets and revise collectively those all down to 300,000.
Yes, I guess that's fair to say. There's some budgets that are up for, as you'll note in the budget messages.
Sure, but collectively. The bottom line number for the town. Yes. Yeah, thank you.
So health insurance is up 6%, 6.06% over FY11. That's $315,000 right off the top that we have to approve. And yet that's a little bit down from our forecast, but still a significant number. The pension actually went down $15,000, and these are actual numbers we've received from the county, so we have a fair degree of reliability for them. Collective bargaining, the FY12 budget funds the two settled union contracts. It makes no provisions for the three union contracts that are not settled or the non-union staff. Hopefully we'll be able to address that later in terms of the non-union staff. But for the unions that haven't settled yet, it is what it is. And we will have to, and I'm aware of that and prepared to make those changes, but right now the budget is not funding contracts that are not settled. Conservation funds, there's no allocation again into the Driftway and Conservation Fund for $5,000. Public building maintenance, I think we've put a CPC request in for Gates School, which hopefully, if we get that funding, we can start to make some long-term decisions about our public buildings, of which Gates seems to be the cornerstone. If CPC does not approve that funding, I will probably revise my recommendations for the capital planning so that we can fund that and get it done. It's got to be done. Couple of new things in the budget. Cable access, we now have a brand new cable studio. The PEG access grant money that we get really needs to be funding staff and equipment there now on a regular basis. And in the previous years, we've used the cable money to support technology. It needs to be supported by the general fund. That support and money from PEG access needs to go away for technology. We've done a little of that this year, but that'll, as we go forward, be a big hit to the school and the town because we won't have that as a source of revenue. The FY12 budget, you'll see some budgets are lower in FY11 than FY12. It's because we pulled all of the technology-related expenses on the town side and put it into the IT budget. So when you see significant decreases in Jane's budget, in Mary's budget, that's because it's been pulled out and put into IT because we'll actually have a real IT department in FY12. The indirects have been updated. The only other significant thing driving the FY12 budget is the veteran services. The veteran services budget's gone from $16,000 to $50,000, plus recommends the hiring of a part-time clerk. That's a reflection of the sign of the times in terms of the number of conflicts the country's involved in, Vietnam veterans dying and their widows receiving benefits, a number of benefits, veterans having hard times. So the benefits have been extended, they've been expanded, and many more people are in need of those services. At this point, it's hard to say whether we'll get through FY11, and I hope, you know, FY12 will be sufficient. Even with the 50,000, though, you might not know. We've gone from 3 to 22 eligible veterans in the last 3 months. So that's a significant, unexpected cost to the town in terms of having to adjust that. Two more points. One is we have 16 less FTEs than we did in 2008. So
2008?
Yep, I think so. Let's see, 16 since FY08 on the town side. So we're not growing, we're backtracking. Most of the clerks, as you know, in this building work less than full-time, and we may be looking at some additional reductions if local aid is more than the 4% we're carrying. We have no place else to go. I'm required to give you a balanced budget. I'm not happy in terms of what I would like to do, what your department heads would like to do as you read their goals and objectives. As long as the fixed costs continue to increase, there's not a lot of wiggle room we have, and we might have to have some hard choices about looking at the level of service we continue to provide. But that being said, I'm really impressed with the quality and caliber of the goals that people are still coming forth and doing, and the extra work they're doing in terms of the management and administration of the town, and I think you can all be proud of them. As you review their budgets, I think you'll see that.
Question from the board, Mr. Norton.
Just a comment. FTEs, I think, is a term that a lot of people put it down. Full-time employees. So that's 16 full-time employees less now than 2008. So.
That's town side.
That's
town
on the town side.
That's in the budget book, so you can see that graph.
No, that was it. No.
Tricia, thank you very much.
This is what I was looking for.
Somewhat of a sobering approach to this coming budget that we're going to be running into.
Mr. Chair, if I could just say something. Tricia, you know, just looking at the documentation you and your staff have provided us, this is very, very impressive. And the summary up front is incredibly helpful. And I know you thanked all the department heads and everything, but I just wanted to thank you for putting this together in such a clearly laid out way. And it's just very impressive to have it right like this. Regardless of the news is good or bad, facts are facts. And this is a job well done. Thank you.
Thank you.
With that, I guess we should probably get started with the discussion of our 2012 budgets. And first on tap is the assessors. So I'd ask Steve if you could come on up. What I'd like to do is I'd like to have you, Steve, read the mission statement so that people have an idea exactly what the mission of the assessor's office is.
The assessor's office is responsible for the administration of all laws and regulations regarding property tax assessments. In accordance with Massachusetts General Law and Department of Revenue guidelines, the office administers a valuation of real estate, personal property, motor vehicle, and boat excise.
And I know that you've set forth some goals and some objectives, some of which you've met. Are there any that you'd like to highlight, at least for us, and also for the public in general, Steve?
We've been successful the last couple of years in reducing the amount of abatement filings. In one sense, we're a little surprised that we've been successful in reducing abatement filings. We think that as I said here, encouraging taxpayer participation, perhaps with emailing or mailings of their property assessment data, if we can be told that information is inaccurate, I think it'll go a long way into telling us that perhaps, you know, we have some information that could be corrected or improved. It also saves us some field work, because field work is what costs us money and time. So that's one thing on a goal and objective that I think we should strive for, and I think we can do that. There's others there as well that We have vacant parcels in generally the West End that are difficult to sometimes locate, quite honestly, on the assessor's maps. The assessor's maps are not meant to be surveys. They're meant to be simply a total of the parcel count in town. But unfortunately, over the years, we haven't had the time or the resources to often do that. But we're going to try our best to say, well, if there's a particular parcel that we have an assessment on, but we're not sure if it's next to this parcel or next to that parcel, because it could be on a town line that was never surveyed. It was a deed that was so questionable or vague that was just handed down over the years through a family, never went through a title search. It was a family seal of a dollar or something. Those kind of things are what we want to try to do with them.
Are those properties being, assessed?
They're assessed, but I can't tell you, quite honestly, that the parcel was right there or one parcel over.
Okay.
Only because it's been going on for quite honestly, decades.
I noticed that in the DPW budget, they're looking to increase or to include surveying, I think.
That's what
and
we,
is that what you're looking to try to capture?
That's one of the reasons why this was discussed, that perhaps in connection with the DPW we could
it
do
might have
this.
Been actually the capital plan. What was it? So it's the capital plan, okay, 37, whatever. But I'm like, okay, so that you could utilize that.
Yes, hopefully. I mean, if their time and ours can be coordinated and the resources are there, we can do that.
One of the things I noticed is that you're going to be reassessing or reevaluating property for 2012, which you do every 3 years. So this is the year that we do it. And I know that from your goals and assessments or accomplishments of trying to look at the abatements, the numbers have gone down significantly in the 2 years, which really puts you and your department in assessing property probably really at the values of what they are. Question I had with the reevaluation is, if the reevaluations go down to some extent, how does that impact the general public as far as taxes go, as far as, you know, increasing taxes and others? If the property values go down, ultimately, we're going to have further shortfall.
The levy is the levy.
So the tax rate goes up for the
exactly.
people.
If the values decrease, which, you know, so far the last couple of years, for example, this year it was a 5% decrease overall.
I ask that because people in the public might
yeah.
say, well, gee, my taxes
right.
went down, so
right.
why am I, you
value
know.
Went down at correct. 15%, why are my taxes done accordingly? Well, because
everybody's
the way 2.5 is written, that's so if the bottom fell out, it wouldn't happen.
Right. Okay. Right. Questions from the board on the goals and assessments? Accomplishments.
Just a quick one. I thought your goals were great. They were, you know, reduce abatements, improve collections, you know, look at vacant parcels. They're really objective things that you can do, and it's going to take a while to get it done. I thought it was great. And then John mentioned the reevaluation. Just so people know, that costs the town, what do we estimate, $75,000 to do a reevaluation of the properties. It has to be done, and it's a lot of work, and this is the year that it happens. And
I should point out, though, that we have about 9,000, 8,000 plus parcels, so on a cost per parcel basis, it isn't unusual to spend, you know, $8 or $9 a parcel or something to do this. And most of the work in the interim years, we do ourselves.
Right.
We adjust value and change assessments. It's all done in-house.
Steve, one question. What is an abutters list as a source of revenue?
A source of revenue, yes. If somebody comes in and needs an abutters list for the planning or zoning, we prepare that, and there's a fee.
Okay. So if I wanted to
yes, if you
have a wedding or something, I needed to tell the 10 people around.
If you were doing some improvement that was necessary, that the zoning or planning or somebody needed some, the name of those abutters, we provide that list,
okay.
and there's a fee.
Thanks.
Well, then, let's, if we could, turn to your budget then, Steve, if that's all right. And it looks as though that between you and the town administrator, there's a slight discrepancy in the amount that you requested and the amount that was recommended, of about $8,000 as compared to the fiscal year from FY11, which is about $1,000 less. The town administrator's reducing the FY11 by about $1,000. Just those areas, what are the areas that...
Well, the $8,000 is being shifted to the IT budget. That's our software.
Okay.
Appraisal software.
Other than that, then everything's pretty much in order.
Exactly. Then. There's some small changes in postage and other things of that nature, but the personnel is just contractual adjustments.
Other questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman, just, last year we changed the way, I believe, the procedure. We didn't vote to approve these, if my memory serves me correctly, individually at night. We waited till the end, Kim, didn't we? So,
yeah, we waited till, I think, advisory to take a look at it, and then I think that's pursuant to the charter, and then from there.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Advisory voted them all Thursday night, but yeah, I mean, the thing is, if you get a, you know, if we know in February we're going to get a local aid cut, and you've voted all these budgets, you're going to have to go back and rescind.
Okay, so just
leave
it the
way it is. What you did at your last meeting in February is you just voted them.
So we'll wait until February, but we're looking at it for questioning right now at this point, and then if there's no major drastic reduction in local aid from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, which will affect our budget, then we'll end up voting them straight then and there.
Thank you.
So kind of a question and answer time period. So if anybody wants to ask a lot of questions, Steve, we got him here. Mr. Vignani.
Just a quick question. On the technical services, $8,000 has been taken out. Tricia, where did that go? Where's the department where that went?
IT, is it in the book? Which is
155.
Is it after my budget? Where do we stick it now in general government?
I put mine numerically, so.
I don't see it in here.
It's there. And it might be after the town administrator. It might be after 129.
It is. It's right after my budget in the front section. It's your budget, my budget, and then IT.
Is it
there? It is. It's after, it's the IT.
General Administrator.
Let's see if it's this bullet, after the bullet.
Okay. Should be right there. Tom.
After Administrator?
Yeah.
Oh, so it doesn't have its own tab. It's not a, I see.
Oh, it doesn't have a tab?
This one does.
Wait. It will when there's a person in there.
Don't take it personally.
Wait, I don't have a tab.
I don't either. It's right, it's in the same one as 120.
Oh, yeah. Okay, gotcha.
So the the technical services of $100,000, there's two or three departments in here where that went, and that's where that is.
Yep.
Thanks.
Questions? No? Steve, thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
I'd like to move on to the next one, but before we do, I'm going to just take a quick break. I need to grab my book. Actually, I have my questions in my book, which I inadvertently had taken Mr. Norton's, who does have that tab. So if we could take like a 2 minute, if you keep rolling, I'm just going to grab it. Town clerk.
Town clerk, Bernice.
Thank you.
How are you tonight?
Good, thanks. You?
Good. Thank you. If you could just, I guess, we'll have everyone read the
mission.
Mission statement, and we'll start everyone by doing that.
The mission of the Office of the Town Clerk is to serve as the official record keeper and archivist of the town records and statistics, and to coordinate and oversee elections and voter registration in compliance with Massachusetts and local law in order to assure sound documentation and access to local government for the general public and town government. To accurately establish, maintain, and certify all vital statistics of the town, and to collect and administer licenses, registrations, and permits required by Massachusetts general laws and town bylaws. To provide courteous, competent, and efficient service to the community in an effort to establish public confidence and respect for government.
Thank you, Bernice. Sorry about that. And again, just looking over at your goals and accomplishments and objectives, I noticed when I was looking at the archives, obviously increasing staff is one of your goals.
One of my goals for 2012.
And the question I had when I was looking at this is, I understand that there are a few people who are no longer volunteering to do it. So is there anybody down there at all during the Wednesdays that the archives are open?
The archivist is there most Wednesdays.
Okay.
Our hours a little more limited than they were before.
Okay.
We still have two people who are working with the transcription information that they've been doing on vital records for some period of time. But their activity within the rest of the archives is very limited. And we have one person who has volunteered but has not yet had an opportunity to be trained. So currently there's really one person who's doing the work of the archives.
When I read it, I was like, the way I read it, and forgive me for misinterpreting it, it sounded as though nobody was down there. And I was thinking, oh, my gosh, you know, out of fear because of the archives and, you know, obviously access. But
it's really very important. CPC has really invested in downstairs, and they've done a really good job with the archives. And we have been doing a good job as well. And to end up with this limited situation that we have right now, we're really hoping to fix that.
The other question I had was your second, which was revenue, increase the revenue through the fee structure. I was just wondering if you could just briefly explain what do you envision as far as increasing the fee structure? What fees are we talking about for people in the public?
I'm not looking at most vital records at the moment, and the reason I'm not is vital records are in something of a flux. The state is beginning the 1st of January. We have been training to take birth records, and birth records will be online for all new births beginning the middle of January of this year. And they are changing our need for how we provide vital records. They are going to have to be on secure paper. They're going to have to be on archival paper. So that's going to be for all vital records. And vital records are going to be standardized throughout the state. Because they are in that situation right now, they haven't really made a determination about whether or not communities are going to end up making a contribution back to the state in terms of part of what we take in on vitals. So I'm not touching vitals, other than two types of vitals. Maybe a little more than two types of vitals. We do affidavits and corrections. We primarily do affidavits and corrections on deaths. They're very time-consuming. They are corrections that have occurred somewhere along the line, either from the informant to a funeral director or in the funeral director's records themselves. We have to do those corrections. They're very time-consuming. And we currently only charge a minimum $10 for doing that. It should be more. We do home births. We don't do a great many of them in a year, but that means we're operating as the hospital community when we do that. So we are creating a birth record, which we normally don't do, the hospital community does. We do adoptions, and adoptions are really creating a record again also from a different set of information. Those should be considered for a greater fee because they really do represent a great deal more work. We also have several types of professions. Under Mass General Law, we are entitled to charge them a fee for one time when they begin their business or they've maintained their business. This is separate from a DBA. This is a different kind.
So what are you actually meaning?
Say someone who was an optician in town, someone who was a chiropractor. There are various kinds of professions. There is a fee involved when they first begin their business. We have not, in most towns traditionally, do not charge them. We could look at those kinds of things, and those are what we're considering.
Other questions from the board in the goals and objectives?
I had one question. Bernice, I was looking at you had three goals in here, and the first two, one was increasing staff. That's really just trying to hire some people.
Increasing staff in the archives.
Yeah. Or finding volunteers.
Yeah, volunteers. That's not paying anyone.
Right. And then increasing revenue, which is going to be going over, you know, a sheet and saying increase into this. And the third one is the data input for the state to take advantage of that.
Right.
The first two I just didn't think were, I didn't know if there were other goals in terms of what you hope to do with your department as opposed to get volunteers and raise fees. I just thought that was...
Actually, at this stage of the game, I would say that the three goals we established for 2011, which aren't complete yet, and will be ongoing work through the rest of this year, are plenty to keep us busy. I think those are building on something, especially the third one, is building on the fact that we will be in a position to utilize what the state is developing technically.
Oh, I thought that
was one of our second goals from last
year. What were the other ones from last year?
To do the work of the census for not just the local census, but the federal census, which we have done right up through. At this point, I have attended the reprecincting sections, and we have a reprecincting map that I have not presented to anyone simply because of the time of year we're in.
Mm-hmm.
So we have been working with the census for the entire year. We work to increase dog revenue, and that takes a considerable period of time, and we have managed to do that. And I'm trying to remember what my third goal was, and I think it was related to the vitals, which is ongoing right now. The difference being that the vital goal that I had last year was to get up and running what, in fact, the state is going to start to do.
I thought your goals as being more related to really the historical preservation of a lot of our stuff, because all the stuff you've been doing with CPC to get that. I was surprised not to see that on...
CPC isn't in my goal for this year because, in fact, we are so limited in terms of the archives that we're not in a position where we really can go to CPC and say, we have this project in mind.
Yeah, but have we finished all the ones that we funded?
We are just about finished with everything we funded.
Wow.
And we have not, in the absence of an archivist, in the middle of doing what we did this year, which is, I think we ran 7 elections and in 3 town meetings, which are probably the biggest achievement we have this year, because we managed to lose them all, and we did, yes, this past year.
Right.
But this is still this year as well, because we're still in 2000.
Right, right.
Yeah. So I think we have done as much as we can.
No, I'm not saying that you haven't done. I guess my question was, I expected to see more of, like, the archivist side of, like, your goal to do all the stuff that you've been working on.
You know, the archivist side of what we do is terribly important, but I don't think you can take away the practical side of what we do every day. And the practical side of what we do every day is to meet the demands of the people who are coming in. And those are apt to be people within Town Hall as well as people without Town Hall. And for that reason, we have to see what we can do in terms of revenue and service and performance. And a lot of that is not something that can appear as a goal. It's got to be done every day.
Right, right.
Well, moving on to your budget here, I see, looking at what was requested and what we're looking at, there's a discrepancy in not much, about $4,000 between what you're requesting and what the town administrator had. In comparison to FY11, it's actually a reduction. Both you had a reduction as well as the town administrator. The difference being $1,000 from you, and the town administrator had about a little over $5,000. And which is all that, from my reading, you know, it's just a few itemized things here that are just a difference, you know. So I see nothing significant. You know, obviously reduction is reduction, but I'm saying it's significant. It's you know, just a difference of saying it. 1,000 versus 500, or, you know, a difference of 800, 400, and, you know, along that line.
And our budget varies depending upon what activities are mandated for the year as well.
Questions from the board? Bernice, thank you.
Thank you
very much. A happy holiday. Appreciate it.
Happy
Moving on to the next item, I'd like to see advisory. This will be very quick, believe me. You don't have to, Bob.
This might be a good time.
Sure, I think you're level funded.
come on up, Bob. Before we get started, I do want to at least acknowledge this is an anniversary for advisory for the town of Scituate, and it's a significant anniversary. It's 100 years that the advisory committee has been in existence, and for all the members, including Mr. DiLorenzo, all former members, all current members, it's quite an achievement. So we want to thank you folks and all the people who've donated their time, volunteered to take a look at the financial status and structure of the town, for their participation, their dedication, their volunteerism, and look forward for the next 100 years, cooperation and partnership with all the town boards. So thank you very much to you and to your predecessors and current members.
Thank you, John.
Getting to your budget, I mean, you don't have to get through your goals. We know exactly what advisory does, and obviously it advises on the budget. It's level funded, $90,000.
Level funded for the reserve fund. A little change from last year as we made some changes at the annual town meeting in allocating more a portion of our reserve fund to the personal services and town clerk. And on the expense side, it's really just to support Gene Martin, our recording secretary, and for the printing that we do for the advisory committee reports for a town meeting, for the special town meeting.
And I stand corrected. I said 90,000. I'm talking about the reserve fund. This is 5,300 is what we're talking about.
Right, right. Those are the expenses, and reserve is at 90.
Is at 90.
Thank you.
Questions from the board? That was very easy. Painless. There you go.
Thank you,
Bob.
Thanks, Bob.
Happy holidays.
Thank you,
Jim. That takes care of both 3131 advisory as well as the reserve fund.
And just so people know, the reserve fund has been that number for at least 10 years. Joe, more
20.
Than that? Yeah.
20.
And so the people, and the reserve fund is money that's set aside by town meeting to be allocated by the advisory committee for extraordinary, and I say extraordinary, and unforeseen expenditures. So just money that we set aside each year. So moving on to town accountant.
That's the others first. That's fine, because I'll be here for theirs anyway.
Okay. Let's go to the zoning board then. Well, let's go to Widow's Walk. I'm sorry. Neil, hold on. I'm going to hurry. Let's go to Widow's Walk. Bob, if you could read your mission statement, get set up here, and then if you could read the mission statement, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, Widow's Walk Golf Course endeavors to offer the best valued golf experience on the South Shore by providing a well-manicured championship course with friendly customer service. Scituate residents are granted special policies and pricing to encourage a high level of activity from our community members. It is the intent of this enterprise operation to offset all expenses through the collection of reasonable usage fees.
And again, so people understand, this is an enterprise fund as compared to some of the town departmental budgets. This is one that's self-funded by the people who actually go to it and utilize it. So I see that you have a few goals and objectives. I have some blue ink on them, so I just have a few questions, Bob, to go over. It looks like you're looking to improve. One of the goals is enhancing the food and beverage operation, and that's one of the goals for this coming year that you're looking at. Is that
yes.
fair to say? The other thing is the vandalism at the golf course. Could you just briefly explain to the board that there's been some vandalism? It's obviously gotten worse than in the years, and worse this year as compared to the past years.
We've always had, a bit of it, but it's been minor in nature, just stealing flag sticks and throwing hazard sticks in the ponds and things of that nature, and not a whole lot of costly damage. We're trying to find a way to bring new visitors to our facility who have never been there, and once we capture them, looking to use some social media and email blasts or what have you to try to retain them. That really is the crux of what we're looking at. We've already lined up a couple of new promotional cards to hopefully get some new people in. We used to have a successful program a few years back called the Players Pass that was fairly successful in bringing new people to our facility. They went bankrupt, and I just found a new card that is more New England based as opposed to the other one, which was national based, that that we have signed an agreement with for the upcoming season. We're also trying to get a better percentage of return visitors. We have in recent years gone to our frequent player card, which where people prepay 5 greens fees and they get a card for 6. And that was only available to residents last year, and we would like to offer that to non-residents as well, especially in this time where where all golf courses are just trying to get people in the door. It's everyone's struggling for rounds. Whether people are coming from Scituate or elsewhere, we've got to value that equally. So, it's hopefully that will help to get some more loyal customers.
Mr. Norton?
I know it's a case of diminishing returns, maybe, but has any thought been given this year to raising fees? I know golf courses throughout the state are in, not in great shape, and I'm not suggesting this at all, but have you looked at increasing fees? I thought about it.
Tricia and I talked about it, and of course, we haven't raised fees that, you know, that frequently through the history of, and last year we had, you know, we had decent increase, you know, it was probably a little less than 10%, you know, 5 to 8%, let's say. You know, as Tricia said, you know, it doesn't say that we couldn't raise them at some point next year. I would prefer to see them stay the way they are. I think that what we need to watch out for is too many just blanket discount programs, because I think it's hard to recapture the money. You know, other than the Groupon, which is a significant discount, but we're only letting people buy one Groupon so that they can only make the one visit, as I say, with the idea of getting a lot of new people to visit your facility, and hopefully of that, you know, see how many of them that we can get to love the place and come back on a regular basis.
So right now there's no serious thought to raising fees as of right now?
Not as of right now.
Thank you.
Mr. Murray.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Bob, as you know, I'm not a golfer, but I saw you refer to this, and it's sort of an anecdotal comment I often hear, is that the course is very difficult. And is that actually, do you think, impacting use, or is that just sort of street hum that's doesn't really make a difference, or is it something that you think does actually negatively impact the revenue? And if so, is there anything that we could do about that, either in terms of advertising or tweaking our marketing or making the course easier or something like that? And I have no knowledge about this person.
Without a doubt, it's a very, very difficult golf course. And I think they did an exceptional job. The architect did an exceptional job building the golf course on a very small piece of land. I mean, golf course is built on about 100 acres. The normal 18-hole golf course would take about 150 acres. Because of that, they had to make a choice of either to make the course somewhat dangerous by taking the trees out and becoming a shooting gallery, or by making the course more narrow, which they chose to do, and I think it was the right decision. We're kind of limited as to how much easier we can make it. The grounds crew has done a great job of trying to clear out more, and I think that the people who have been playing the course for a number of years would tell you that it has gotten a little bit more golfer-friendly. That being said, it'll never, ever be an easy golf course. It'll always be very challenging, and more challenging than a lot of people would want to play on a regular basis. Okay. So, yeah, it does impact us, and it's in some ways very unfortunate. On the other hand, we have some people that love the challenge, and I think that's a good point. I think some of our marketing dollars could go to talking about the difficulty, and you get your people who think they're pretty good and want to give it a try. So you know, we may capture some. That might be a good focus on a campaign.
Okay. Thank you.
But it's come a long way though, Bob, from when it first opened.
Oh, I think I think that a lot of the customers have said that, but we are very limited between our environmentally protected areas and so on. It's always going to be difficult. Right. But, yeah, there's no question the feedback from the people who have been playing it regularly will tell you that it has softened up a bit.
Right. I think a lot of the people that initially played it 10 years ago and got that in their head that it was just an impossible golf course to play, if they didn't come back, those are the people you're hearing from. I think people who have come back over the years and have seen what the grounds crew has done as far as clearing up areas and making it much, much more playable, realize that it's a different golf course now than it was 10 years ago.
Hey, see, that's not exactly why I asked the questions, because I've heard that from people. They say, you know, I played it 10, 15 years ago or whatever, and I went back and was like, wow. And so I'm wondering if that is just still out there, but we can combat that somehow to help educate people that it's attainable.
Well, let's get to your numbers, Bob. That's what we're here for. Looking at your total goal, I'm looking at appropriated for FY11. You're at a little over $1.3 million. You requested $1.2 1.284, so 1,284. Town administrator has said recommended about 1.282, which is 1,282. So the discrepancy is really about 2,000. The only thing I noticed, I've noticed a few things, but of significance, repairs and maintenance, you both were about the same. Last year you appropriated 18.5. In light of the situation you're telling us, you know, first thing came to my mind, was that realistic, reducing it by $2,000, realizing that you've been having vandalism? And then the indirect costs, I wasn't really clear on the discrepancy with the $5,000 difference on indirect costs were. I don't know what's
I that? Think Mary said that was primarily insurance, was it?
I think it's primarily insurance. The our insurance agent does an allocation for me of our insurance. Transfer stations to where you are, and I think he calculated last year's differently than he did this year.
Saving us money this year, which is good. The only other one I had was merchandise. I see that last year we appropriated, or the expectations of 67,000, and now it's down by about 8,000 is what you're recommending. Is that because we bought more merchandise than we expected to sell, or I don't know. But
truth be known, that line item is kind of a strange number, because that's really a profit source.
Okay.
The reason that we have asked for less is because our sales in the pro shop are down in light of the economy. So
okay.
It's primarily that. But there's two line items here, that and handicap fees. Both of those really should be income lines. So whatever we spend, we should make more on the other end.
Okay.
So that one. But it is that our sales have been decreasing a little bit because of the economy.
Questions from the board? Mr. Vignani?
Having said that, that's quite a snappy shirt you're wearing there. I encourage everybody to go out and buy a Widow's Walk shirt.
Well, hold on a second. Is it open? It's no longer open, right?
It is. It'll be there
Christmas
Thursday.
Specials, holiday specials for sales, right?
Everything
on sale, so
absolutely.
There you go.
Absolutely.
Any event.
We use our holiday sale as a clearance sale as well.
Mr. Vignani.
And are we on budget to make money in fiscal year 2011?
No, that was a question
we're
I was going
to
ask.
We're on budget to break even.
To break even.
2011. You had an $1,800 deficit in FY10.
Okay, because the revenue projections here at 2.2 are $80,000 less than the expenses that was appropriated. So somehow we've reeled the expenses into... To tie that,
about 7 or 8 years.
Yeah, but not that much. Not the 80.
Yeah. How much are in retained earnings? Any idea?
I think it's 97,000.
I got it somewhere.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah, but when we appropriate retained earnings, that's not
good.
Revenue. No, but we look at that as a
surplus
loss.
Revenue. So you don't want to be appropriating for...
Well, I understand that, but I'm wondering, how do we check... Like, we don't consider it break-even if we appropriate $80,000 of retained earnings.
That's correct.
This breaks even without retained earnings.
Well, in 12, the budget does, yeah.
The budget does, right.
My concern is, as John brought up initially, was the increase of $40,000 in revenue from the dues and subscriptions, and then, you know, another $25,000 or $15,000 from greens fees. In light of, like you say in your thing, every golf course is going through extremely challenging times. So I assume there's a plan in place that if we're not going to hit this revenue number, that there's some expense lines that'll be.
Yeah, it is optimistic, but I don't see any other choice. I mean, I'm hoping that, number one, the economy starts to turn around a little bit. But also I'm hoping that some of these programs that we are going to put in place are going to have some positive effect. And I think that one line item, the dues, there were more different items into that, like the Groupon,
right.
Which we haven't had. The frequent player cards, by opening that up to non-residents, that actually goes into that category.
Yeah, it's just a 25% increase. So I hope you're right, but it's,
well,
like you said, it's optimistic.
I mean, I guess we need to try to deliver a balanced budget, and it's as I say, it's very challenging. And believe me, in going to the national PGA meeting, which happened to be in Boston this year, first one I'd ever been to, I mean, one speaker after another, they were all just talking about trying to keep their head above water, and it's going to be very challenging. And the bottom line is, until people change their spending habits, because so many people have gotten so cautious, you know, it's, you know, we can create a great plan, but you still have to have people willing to
right. But spend. we don't want to create a balanced budget by putting unrealistic revenue numbers in here. So that's my concern there. The another thing that popped up to me was marketing. We decreased marketing from 6,000 to 4,000, yet that seems to be counterintuitive. If we're hoping to market to get people to come in and play again, yet we cut that budget.
Well, see, these companies like Groupon or this Lynx card and that type of thing, essentially they are doing marketing for you, and you know you're giving them product in return.
Right.
So essentially,
about,
we aren't.
You know, the difficulty of the course, and I think Joe can attest to it. Also, the first time I played the course, it was terribly difficult, and now it's just very difficult. So you get people coming here that are used to shooting 90 and they shoot 100, you know, somehow you've got to draw them back in. I think that's where it's going to take marketing dollars through, you know, maybe marketing the difficulty of the course to get people challenged to come back. But that's a line item that stuck out to me that really...
Well, the email blasts.
I think we'll be okay. We've done more different kinds of marketing in the past 10 months than we have in the past 10 years. And to Bob's point, we need to get people to come to the course who've never been, because the lifeblood of that course is his returning customers. Mm-hmm. And they're getting older, and you know that's a group that demographic's going to change, and we need to touch new people. And you know we do have the option of looking at the fees again mid-year, but a lot of the things we have in play for marketing aren't even hitting until April, so we've already paid for those, and then we'll get the bounce. And there's some more of the Boston Metro ads too, I think. The majority of them hit too, so. So I think we'll be okay, but you're right, Tony. I'm not gonna, you know, it's gonna be tough to meet the revenue expectation. The maintenance fee is level funded, so that's a huge benefit.
How long is that contract?
It's got one more year, and then I think we have an optional two, Mary.
Two more.
Yeah.
So fiscal year 12 is the last year.
Well,
it's a calendar year.
It's calendar year.
But I mean, usually you're seeing that maintenance fee go up 4%, 5%, 6%, and it's level, so that helps the course a lot this year.
Right. Two other quick questions. On the technical services, that went down. Does that go to IT? But then that's brought back through the indirect?
Yes, it will in FY 13, I think, because we have to gauge it in FY 12.
Okay, and then cart supplies went up. Are we getting more carts?
No, that's batteries. We have a
replacement plan.
Yeah, plan for both carts and batteries. And last year was our 1 year where we didn't have any battery replacements.
So that's right. Yeah, I guess my biggest two concerns are again the overestimating revenue and not funding marketing. So, and did you see, Mary? Did you see the retained earnings? How much we took from that?
Yeah, 75.
So it's 75,000. That's what's retained? Okay.
No, that's what we used. So in 11, we're projecting a $75,000 loss.
That is based on FY 10 actuals, yeah. So unless...
And then how much is going to be left after we use... How much is left after we use that?
It'll be a little less than $100,000.
So there's still $100,000 in...
Other questions?
Yeah, difficult time.
It is.
Yeah.
Well, one last thing before we let you go, Bob. I know that one of the goals I didn't see, but I know that in FY 2017, the bonds paid off on the golf course. And, of course, we always talk about a clubhouse, and this is not the time to be building, but this may be the time to be thinking about how are the golf courses with the clubhouse doing? Is the clubhouse actually carrying the golf course, is it not, at this point in time? And I was thinking, you know, is that something in the future that in the short term we should be thinking about? Because obviously if the economy turns around 3 or 4 or 5 years,
bonds paid off, we're still stuck with a golf course, but it's not necessarily generating the income that may have been projected during good times, because you have a clubhouse that can do functions, multifunctions, year-round, as opposed to a cinder block bunker with a glorified, you know, snack shack on top of it, I guess, is the way I'm looking at it. So I would only ask that next year or something to think about it, because timing and planning and obviously getting into the queue for capital planning and everything else would be important. But I think I'd want to look at the revenue. Certainly now I think it would be incumbent upon us to see during downtimes, economically, is it worth it? Because, you know, even if we had a clubhouse, we might be still taking on more money, and it's not worth doing it, thereby keeping what we have in place. I don't know.
Christian and I have discussed it, and you know, in fact, I gave her a plan that was sketched out by a fellow that was on our planning board when he was interested in bidding on the restaurant, and we also decided that one of the other real messages at the PGA national meeting was to not take on any unnecessary debt. And so that was on my goals last year, and we did talk about it.
Saw it in this one, too.
And took it off because I didn't think it was a good time to do that, but certainly it's something we plan to revisit.
Well, it's good to note that in 5 years, that's almost $400,000 of annual expenses will be off the books.
Or you could apply to debt to
then
get a better.
Then you could build it and use
clubhouse.
That to, yeah. You know, reinvest.
Right. We have a set of plans. That's just the preliminary.
Just sketched out.
Oh, is that all it was? I thought it was.
Well, I mean, it wasn't anything we paid for. It was just that we discussed possibly, you know, putting it into the RFP. But somebody that had some good knowledge in that field did come up with an idea that I thought was relatively inexpensive for what it would have, the flexibility it would have given us for outings.
But right about now, you're happy you don't have it.
Right about now, you're right. Yes.
That's right.
Yeah.
How's the building itself? Solid? It's just maybe
drafty.
Neil's nodding his head. Nodding his head is all right. Thanks. I know it's a poured foundation. All right. Good. Thanks.
All right. Bob, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Happy holidays. Moving on to planning, which is 175. If we could, as a town planner. Laura, good evening.
Hi, how are you?
If you could also read your mission statement so that people in the audience and TV can understand.
Sure. The mission of the Planning Board and Planning Department of the Town of Scituate is the creation and implementation of long-range plans to provide coordinated guidance and regulation of physical growth and development through the review of subdivision and site development plans, to explore and pursue grant opportunities for the town as directed by the town administrator, and to provide professional advice and technical expertise to the citizens, elected officials, appointed boards and committees, and other departments of the town of Scituate.
Thank you. And obviously you've been very busy this past year from all the initiatives and grants and bylaws, so thank you. Just 2 points I looked at your goals and objectives. One was the risk and challenges. And when I was looking at the risk and challenges for like developments, unfinished developments, and the problems that causes, and I just initially wrote down bonding, assurances, or conditions. Is there any way that in the process that you can get bonds to make sure that things are completed, as opposed, it sounded from what I was reading, you know, some of the developments and infrastructures, you know, haven't been completed or anything along that line, or am I wrong?
No, there's one large subdivision where there have been some issues, and there is a performance bond on that subdivision.
Okay. All right.
We're trying to work with the developer because we think that would be the most efficient way of getting it done. We're also working with town council to collect the bond at the same time, so it's a question of whichever happens first.
Okay. I was wondering if there's any way of being a little more forceful, but then again, if that's the procedure, and I know how bonds and trying to go after bonds, it's not impossible. It's just difficult because it's a hoop and a process you have to jump through. But I'm just curious if there's any way that we could be a little more vigilant to try to exact that money up front, but it may not be.
Particular development you're
no,
talking about?
No, not just in general. In general, a problem.
In general, with every subdivision, we have a performance bond or some form of surety.
All right.
questions from the board on goals and objectives at all? As we get to the numbers. Mr. Murray.
Just a general question. You mentioned the master plan quite a lot through here, which is a good thing. How are we doing on the master plan? And in your professional assessment, how often is the master plan adequately consulted in the decision-making process?
I think actually a lot of the goals of the master plan and the objectives of the master plan have been implemented since it was adopted in 2004. The Harbor Walk is an example of something that was in the master plan that is now being implemented. The streetscape improvements in Greenbush and North Scituate. So they're really, I mean, those are just a few examples, but there really has been a lot of work which has pretty closely followed along the master plan. And I think the planning board is consulting it a lot in terms of particularly economic development right now, because that's an issue that's really claiming a lot of attention.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Thank you. It's good to hear.
Looking at your numbers, between what you requested, which is $114,799, and what the town administrator recommended, which was actually an increase of about $170, I really have no questions. It looks pretty much in line. There's really no difference between your budget and the town administrator's. Questions from the board?
I assume that $3,000 is in the IT budget from the technical services. Are these all like copier maintenance? What is
some of it's PC maintenance reserve. In Laura's case, she had the software license for the ArcView software.
So it's software. So
software, hardware, PC equipment. Replacement, retainer services for troubleshooting. Name it.
Any other questions? Other than that? Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Have a very good holiday. Moving on to inspections. Actually, you know, can we go to Zoning Board of Appeals? I know you're here and there for both, so since it's next in our line of 176, instead of flipping this file back and forth, let's go to the ZBA and then we'll get to the inspections if we could. Pretty much.
Did you get gold on it?
No. Maybe it's in the other one.
Under public safety.
Do you have a goal? Unfortunately, the goals, the mission statement's not in the sequence here. I didn't know if there was one nil that you had for the zoning board at all, or is it just
not for
numbers?
The zoning board, no.
Okay. So why don't we just get to the numbers on the ZBA? It looks as though that what you're requesting and what the town administrator's recommending is a difference of about $1,000 for the ZBA. And it is basically what you're requesting is only an increase of about $500 from our FY11. It doesn't seem like there's much deviation between the two of you.
No.
Questions from the board on this?
No.
That's the quickest one on the ZBA. Okay, we'll move over to inspectional services, which happens to be 241 for inspections.
And just for people, it's a $23,000 budget, and $21,000 of it is part-time employee.
Neil, if you could read the mission statement for inspection services, please.
The mission of the Scituate Inspections Department is to ensure the public safety, health, and welfare as it relates to buildings and structures by conscientious enforcement of state building code, gas and plumbing code, electrical code, weights and measures regulations, state disabilities regulations, and FEMA floodplain regulations. In addition, the inspection department is charged with enforcing the town of Scituate zoning bylaw and applicable general bylaws.
Thank you. When I was looking at your goals, I noticed that one of the goals was to provide opportunities for senior volunteers and student interns.
Yes.
So I know we've had a program with the town and other departments, so this is something that you're looking to try to implement at least.
We're actually doing it right now. We have a senior working in the department a few hours a week, and we have a Scituate High School student intern, kind of a careers to whether people who are interested in like architecture and building and things like that, I sent over, there's a program at the high school that encourages them to go out and get a little, like a Northeastern, but on a lesser scale, little on-the-job training, and get involved in seeing what we do and to see if they really are interested.
Good.
That's working out very well. We've been doing it now for, this is our third year doing that.
And the only other two things, I noticed that your expenditures, you had over 90% of the inspectionals department budget is for essential personnel. Five out of your six inspectors are paid by the inspections, and that they don't receive any benefits from the town. In other words, that the these are people who, five out of the six are get paid by what's generated. They pay for right. themselves.
They get paid $15 per inspection, and they typically generate more income through fees than
they're paid. And the only other thing is I noticed that proper equipment must be provided. I know that in your 16 years as building commissioner, knock on wood, nobody's been injured. Obviously, we want to keep that record intact.
He's filed a claim. They've probably been injured.
But, you know, and we'll keep knocking on wood.
That's
correct. Providing proper equipment, is that certainly obviously a goal? You've done that before. Is there obviously a budget item that you're looking to increase equipment at all or anything like that that's of need?
No, the fund that's in special agency supplies has been adequate.
Outside of that, any other questions from goals and objectives from the board before we get to the numbers?
I just have one quick question. And Mary, maybe I'm misreading this. The fiscal year, the description of revenue, it has building permits going from 87,000 to 210,000?
That's to date. 87,000 is.
FY 11, the 87,000 is just fiscal year to date.
Okay, so we don't have a fiscal year 2011 number.
Yeah, that's through 5 months, I believe. Is that right?
Yeah.
And was fiscal year 11, I mean, what was the projected for 11? I guess that's the number that's missing.
What, the 210,000, whatever I can watch.
Same. Thanks.
Looking at your numbers, Neil, it looks as though that you've recommended it's a deviation of only $700.
Right.
Between what you're projecting, about 205,000, as opposed to the town administrator, which is 204,500. So it's 700 is really what it is. You had $200 on top of it. But outside of that, I have no questions. Questions from the board?
No.
Thank you.
Neil, thank you again.
Thanks.
Happy holidays.
Same
appreciate
you.
It. Moving on to the next one, which is town accountant, if we could. Mary? Which is 135 for the board.
Stabilization. Okay.
If you could, Mary, read the mission statement, if you don't mind.
Okay. The mission of the town accountant's office is to protect the fiduciary interests of the town by providing independent, timely oversight of the town's finances, and by ensuring that financial transactions are executed legally, efficiently, and effectively in accordance with federal, state, and local law, as well as in adherence to generally accepted accounting principles.
Obviously, you have a lot of goals and you have objectives, and is there anything you wanted to highlight for the past year, at least that you...
My most exciting thing is that we're going to have an IT person.
Yeah.
Good.
And I can give that up.
I
can really get to my goals and objectives more than I've been able to, actually. So I'm looking forward to it.
Questions on the board on the goals and objectives, at least at this point?
Nope. I circled IT. Obviously, your department's done a great job band-aiding our IT issues for the last decade.
Taking up a lot of time. And
so moving on to... just your numbers, the discrepancy that you have, it's about a 11,000, a little over 11,000, almost 12,000 difference between what you've projected and requested and what the town administrators had.
About 10,000 of that is software maintenance for the accounting program, IT,
okay.
And then an increase in the audit of 10,000 because I'm going to go out to RFP, and the last time it was done, we didn't really have that much money, so we didn't get very many responses. So,
yep, you
increased it.
Technical services is what I had highlighted, so that's the difference. Okay, Other questions from the board?
What is the $40,000 that's staying? Is that the audit?
That's for the audit.
Okay. So $10,000 went out for software, blah, blah. $40,000 stayed in for the audit. And the capital plan, you didn't, or the equipment, what did you?
Oh, that, what I bought this year was the SQL Server update I needed for the accounting software. It's just been installed and is working wonderful. Great. And next year that will be the IT person can worry about it.
Any other? Mentioned IT yet.
Mary, thank you.
Again, John, I just like to say all the graphs, all the charts, all the new financial reports that you see all during the year, Mary does. So in addition to what she always did, she is really had to regroup last year.
So, well, it makes it easier for us. And not if it's easier for us, it's going to be easier for the public and for them to understand. So appreciate that.
Can I ask you to do one more?
Sure.
If we can just get a summary, like on the front page, it has every single department listed and just, you know, like that other thing has the actuals, the 9, 10.
It's just, we can't. Yeah. Without, she can't create a briefer document than I gave you.
I haven't had a chance to work it out. Yeah. I just took one that comes off, canned this? Off the system.
Well, an Excel spreadsheet where it's just one line, so we can look at it at any point in time.
I can do it.
I mean, I can do it.
You have.
Yeah, I can do it. But I can get one that generates it nice and neatly. And
I'll do it in Excel. Don't bother.
No. Mary, thank you.
You can do it, too, because I think Maura wants it in advisory.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can do it. I have something very similar.
Okay.
Thank you again. Folks, that completes agenda item number 7, which is a discussion on the FY12 budgets. Moving on, I'd like to move to agenda item number 8, which is a discussion vote, the charge of the town's 375th anniversary.
John, I just have to run across the hall. I just have to run out for a second.
Sure. So bear with us for just one moment while we get to that agenda. All right. This is a charge. Should we read it, or? Yeah. Why not? Who's the clerk of a board here? Is it Mr. Vignani?
Murray. He hasn't done anything for.
Would you like me to read it?
Yeah, I'm not on it, but.
Yes, if you could.
Charge creating a 375th anniversary celebration committee. The Board of Selectmen shall establish and appoint a committee to be known as the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee. The 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee will be composed of a minimum of 7 members representing a cross-section of the community and will serve for a term of 1 year. Nothing herein shall limit the Board of Selectmen from appointing more than 7 members if it is deemed to be in the town's best interest. The Board shall fill vacancies as they occur. The committee shall initiate, develop, and plan programs, activities, and events that reflect the town's community history, spirit, and character in recognition of the 375th anniversary of its founding. The committee shall prepare a report for the annual town report and will meet at least twice with the Board of Selectmen, noting its progress and any obstacles encountered. The committee shall be permitted to expend such sums raised through donations or other sources in accordance with all applicable town rules and regulations and established accounting procedures. All funds will remain within the custody of the town treasurer. The committee shall elect a chair, vice chair, and clerk, and take minutes at meetings. In an effort to allow for as broad an array of participants as possible, the board will endeavor to appoint individuals to the committee that are representative of the groups listed below, but this should not in any way limit its ability to appoint from other areas as well. Town hall staff, members of boards and committees, Council on Aging, Police Department, the Cable Studio, School Department and Parent Organizations, Recreation Department, Historical Society, Historical Committee, Fire Department, Business Community and Chamber of Commerce, Churches and other religious organizations, Harbor Merchants Association, American Legion and the VFW, community services such as Rotaries, Lions Clubs, and the Knights of Columbus. And again, this list is not exhaustive and is merely a sampling of representative groups to consider. A sample of types of events undertaken in other communities for anniversary celebrations, for example, could be townwide pancake breakfast or dinner. That sounds good. A reception for seniors 80 years or 80 plus years old, tree planting or tree plantings, 375th anniversary gala, townwide birthday party, golf tournament, fireworks display, 375th anniversary parade, townwide picnic, musical events, historical walk and talk, a viewing of archival documents, a 5K road race, community service, student essay competition.
Thank you. So five things that you really need to glean. One is the committee's known as the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee. Two, minimum of seven people should be participating, and we'd like to augment that so as many people from a cross-section of our community are involved. The objective, obviously, is to throw a birthday party on behalf of the town with events reflecting the town's history and the character and recognition of the birthday. There'll be something that we'd like to have put in our town report, as well as meeting with the Board of Selectmen as to the progress. And then the only other thing is trying to donate funds, generate funds in order to pay for it. So look forward to the charge and look forward to hopefully many people getting involved, which I can see at our next agenda item. Is it the next one? Yeah, we may have two people. So,
just a comment, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
One thing that just was missing in the charge is that the meetings will be posted, I assume, as normally. And it talks about minutes and all that sort of stuff. But just to remind people that these will be posted as well.
Okay. Moving on to the next agenda item, number 9, which happens to be an appointment of the 375th anniversary. Oh, do we need a motion for that charge? I think we do.
Yes.
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to adopt the charge creating a 375th anniversary celebration committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? Seeing none. Any questions from the audience? No. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Was there a question? Just checking. Moving on to agenda item number 9, the appointments.
He wants to be on the committee.
I was wondering if he was. That's why I was curious if that hand was going up. Of the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee and Historic Commission. And I see that if we could start with the Historic Commission, I see that the applicant is Mr. David Corbin, who has submitted his application, has a great deal of experience, grew up in the town as a native, and certainly dedicated himself to a lot of historical buildings and information about the town, and he's looking to get on the commission. Mr. Corbin, could you come up to address the board? Would you like to say anything in advance of your
application? Well, I'd like to thank you all for this opportunity of letting me come this evening. For those of you who don't know me, my name is David Corbin. I'm no longer a resident of the town. I live in the town of Hanover, but I was born and raised here. I've spent quite a bit of time with various research projects. I've been for some time a member of the Historical Society, continue to be a member of the Historical Society, and sort of a hobby, or what keeps me busy when I'm not working, is historical research. And though I live outside the town of Scituate, my research is all about the town of Scituate. So I'd like to take some of my the knowledge that I've picked up over the years and give some of it back in the form of serving on the Scituate Historic Commission. I understood that there was a vacancy coming up, and I was encouraged to put my name in, which I did. And I would really like the chance to sit on the commission and show you what I can do.
Motion, Mr.
Chairman? Just other than I think Hanover used to be a part of Scituate, so I don't see a difference there, Mr. Corbin.
It was until 1727, yeah.
I'd entertain a motion, please.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint David Corbin to the Historical Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Right.
I appreciate
David.
It.
Thank you, gentlemen.
David, thank you.
Thank
Happy
you.
Holidays.
You too. Thank you.
Moving on to the appointment of the two members. There are two members, actually, who are looking to get on the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee. Entertain a motion, if we could.
Sure. Move the Selectmen vote to appoint Edward Cavell to the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And there's another one, too.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Elaine Bargarzoni to the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee.
Seconded
by Mr. Vignani. Discussion? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Congratulations, folks, and thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 10. This is Mr. Ryan Owens looking to resign and would to entertain a motion from the Pier 44 Committee.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the resignation of Ryan Owens from the building Pier 44 Building Options and Feasibility Study Committee, and further to wish Dr. Owens all the best in his future endeavors.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion?
Mr. Chair? Just Mr. Murray. Quick comment that Mr. Owens is resigning because he's moving from Scituate, actually out to the Midwest, and so therefore won't be able to participate.
Thank you. Did you have one, Mr. Vignani?
I was going to say the same thing, just he didn't get off the committee for any other reason than he's moving out of town.
Having said that, all in favor, I guess? Or do we have to, is that a motion?
Aye.
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 Is it unanimous, did I hear? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Moving on to agenda item number 11. It's a discussion vote, the annual license renewals. So.
Would you like a motion on this, Reed?
Yeah, before we do, I wanted to address Madfish. Madfish is looking to renew their liquor license for 2011, and unfortunately they have not met the requirements of the ABCC for submitting the documentation that they need to. So I think as a board we should at least vote those members who have qualified and met the requirements, which is everyone but Madfish at this time. And until they do meet the requirements, then I think we should probably disapprove their application.
Just not vote it, or?
No. Disapprove.
We need to disapprove it, actually, until they meet it.
It's a vacant lot.
Right.
Mm. So, would you like a motion on that, Mr. Chair?
Yeah, I would say either way, either vote them up and then do a separate one for Madfish, or do Madfish first and then vote them up.
Why don't we move the Board of Selectmen vote to, what was the word,
disapprove.
To disapprove the application of Madfish.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. Discussion? Seeing none, any questions from the audience? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. All right.
Next. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following liquor licenses for 2011. The Granite Gill Grill, TK O'Malley Sports Cafe, TAM BTC, DBA Front Street Gourmet Wine and Spirits, Mill Wharf Restaurant, Scituate Country Club, The Winery, and Riva's Restaurant.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none, any questions? None. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following common vicular's license for 2011. The Gannett Grill, TK O'Malley Sports Cafe, TAM BTC, Inc., doing business as Front Street Gourmet Wine and Spirits, Mill Wharf Restaurant, Scituate Country Club, Riva's Restaurant, and The Winery.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? Seeing none, questions from the audience? None. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following entertainment licenses for 2011. The Gannett Grill, Mill Wharf Restaurant, TK O'Malley's Sports Cafe, and Scituate Country Club.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none. Questions from the audience? None. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following Hawker Peddler's license for 2011. The Gannett Grill and Harvest Food Club.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Question? What is Harvest Food Club? Yeah, you know? Who was that?
They're,
just curious.
They're one of the vendors at the North Scituate.
The farmer's market?
Farmer's market. I think they sell.
Sorry, just put you on the point.
No, no, no. I believe they sell meats. Gotcha. Vacuum packed meat.
Yeah. Good. All right. Any other questions? Seeing none, any questions from the audience? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Good. That brings us to agenda item number 12. It's a discussion vote to close the annual town meeting warrant for April 11th, 2011. Entertain a motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to close the annual town meeting warrant at the current time. Is that what we're looking for?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
9:02.
Yeah.
9:02 p.m.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? Seeing none. Questions? None. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Moving right along. Other business? Mr. Murray?
None.
Mr. Vignani?
I can't think of anything off the top of my head. Except have a happy holiday.
Mr. Harris?
Ditto.
Mr. Norton?
None.
Very good. I'll join in that. None. Moving on to agenda item number 14, correspondence. I think there's one.
It's for the clerk to read, Mr. Vignani.
Yes. Thank you for stepping in for me. This is a letter to Al Bangert. Dear Al, the Cedar Point Association wants to know what a great job Mike Breen and the guys of the Highway Division did in cleaning up Lighthouse Park parking lot in preparation for the helicopter landing last Saturday at the Lighthouse. The fact that the parking lot was clean made it safe for the helicopter to land and ensured the safety of those in attendance. The Highway Division also delivered a timely manner the sawhorses that were needed. Please let the highway personnel know how much we appreciate their help. From David Ball, the president.
And I can attest to that, because I went to it and I forgot to bring my sunglasses, and I can say if you're not there without glasses, it's like getting shot by a sandblaster, because the sand hits, the helicopter goes, it's like a windstorm. So
where'd you go?
The lighthouse park.
Oh, in the helicopter.
I wish. No, I wasn't. But anyway, I'm standing on the side, and I have to say I'm very glad they did clean it, so thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 15, minutes.
Move the minutes of January 5th, 2010.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Murray. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Moving on to agenda item number 16. Folks, we are going into executive session, and the reason we do so is because if we were to discuss these items in open meeting, it would have a prejudicial and detrimental effect on the town. And specifically, we're dealing with pending litigation and also labor negotiation, union as well as non-union. So I'd like to take a roll call vote, but before I do, I want to say thank you very much for this year and wish you all a Merry Christmas, happy holidays, and a Happy New Year. We look forward to seeing you in 2 weeks. If we could have a roll call vote.
Mr. Murray?
Yes.
Mr. Vignon?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Good
night, folks. Thank you. Thank you, John.
I have a-